Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Common Enemies, Georgetown Basketball, Miami Football, and the Racial Transformation of College Sports by Thomas F. Schaller. Narrated by Kyle Tait. Preface. As a teenager and during my college undergraduate years in the 1980s, I hated Georgetown basketball and Miami football. It's easy to convince myself today that my rooting interests were valid because I grew up in upstate New York, home to Hoyas basketball rival Syracuse University, and later attended Florida State University, FSU, one of the Hurricanes' primary football foes. I was lucky to see in person two of the most storied games in those two rivalries, the 1985 Syracuse-Georgetown game at the Carrier Dome, and the 1987 FSU-Miami game at Doak Campbell Stadium. I was pleased that Syracuse won thanks to Dwayne Pearl Washington's shot in the waning seconds, and was devastated 2 years later in Tallahassee when the Seminoles squandered what seemed like an insurmountable 19-3 halftime lead, and thus their chance to win FSU's first national championship. But I would be lying if I did not confess that part of my hatred toward both the Hoyas and the Hurricanes partly derived from the fact that they were, for lack of a better term, black programs, whose posture and performance seemed foreign to me, a white kid who grew up in an almost entirely white suburb of Albany, New York. Sure, the Syracuse Orange Men basketball and Seminole football teams also relied heavily on talented black athletes. Heck, now retired Syracuse center Derek Coleman and Florida State cornerback Deion Sanders, both African-American superstars, remain two of my favorite professional athletes. But only later, as I came to better understand the meaning of race in U.S. sports, which is to say the meaning of race itself in the United States, did I fully appreciate how important and impactful those Georgetown and Miami teams were. This audiobook is a byproduct of that awakening. As set forth in the opening chapter, my primary argument in the audiobook is straightforward. During the pivotal 1980s, Georgetown basketball and Miami football helped pioneer the emergence of what sports writer Bill Roden calls the black style of play in major college televised sports. Neither team originated this style, nor did either practice it exclusively. But the Hoyas and Hurricanes are rightly remembered for accelerating both the on-field and off-field changes that led to the deeper cultural integration of Division I men's basketball and football, following the preceding literal integration of major college sports. That hard-fought battle by black athletes and coaches during the post-war period to integrate major college sports, especially at universities in the segregated South, is my focus in Chapter 2. In it, I chronicle the key actors and moments of this sometimes glorious, but more often painful transformation. What's most fascinating is that, though both Georgetown basketball and Miami football played their own small roles in the integration of college sports, the Hoyas and the Canes were relatively lackluster, even obscure programs during this formative era. That obscurity is what made these two programs, their universities, and their surrounding cities, such unlikely incubators for the second wave racial revolution within college sports that took place during the 1980s, the subject of Chapter 3. In the years leading up to the emergence of the Hoyas and the Hurricanes as national powerhouses, Washington and Miami experienced rapid, tumultuous, and sometimes violent racial transformations. Though different in important aspects, the 1968 riots in Washington and the 1980 riots in Miami were important historical backdrops to the respective emergence of the Hoyas and the Hurricanes. Chapter 4 chronicles the 1983 and 84 college athletic season during which the Hurricanes and the Hoyas won their first national championships. Those two titles cannot be properly understood without examining the years of fits and starts progress for both programs prior to that fateful season. Accordingly, I also recount key moments for each program that set the stage for Miami and Georgetown to burst onto the national stage in such dramatic fashion in the early 1980s. The fifth chapter offers deeper biographical portraits of the two coaches and two athletes who in many ways defined those 1980s Hoyas and Hurricanes teams. Georgetown's John Thompson and Patrick Ewing, and Miami's Jimmy Johnson and Michael Irvin. Other players, coaches, and administrators contributed significantly to forging and sustaining these two sporting dynasties. But beyond leading their teams to some of their greatest sporting achievements, these four men were notable for developing each program's uniquely racialized identity. In Chapter 6, I examine the lasting cultural and commercial imprints left by Georgetown basketball and Miami football. In particular, I discuss how the nascent black style of play forever changed how players and teams in major college men's sports are marketed and sold to alumni, sports fans, and consumers. From Spike Lee movies to South Florida rap albums, Georgetown and Miami quickly morphed from mere sports programs into cultural icons with far-reaching influence, especially within the African American and later Latino communities. From Hoya paranoia to the U, Georgetown and Miami commodified the black style, thereby aiding its transformation into the now familiar experience, forged at the intersection of sports, popular culture, and mass market branding. Finally, in the concluding chapter, I widen the lens to assess the impact of black and other minority college athletes and coaches on today's sports, culture, and politics. I specifically address how those athletes and coaches changed eligibility standards for student athletes, how the continuing efforts to diversify coaching staffs and administrative ranks are succeeding in some ways, yet failing in others, how contemporary minority athletes are fighting back against the corporate exploitation of their likenesses for profit, and how today's amateur athletes are using sports to change public awareness and attitudes on issues of race. Writing a book is, first and foremost, a learning experience for the author. Obviously, that experience involves inquiry into the book's subject matter. But in my three previous books and doctoral dissertation, I also learned what I presume many other authors do, namely, how challenging it is to find the resources and time to write a book, including how, and how not, to balance completion of such a large endeavor against other, often more important, professional and personal goals. In that regard, this book is no different. What is different about writing Common Enemies is that it changed how I think about both sports and race. That is, it changed me not only as a writer, but also as a fan. I look at and root for different athletes, coaches, universities, and professional sports teams, and for different reasons than those I did before starting this project. My great regret is that I arrived at this new perspective too late to enjoy in real time those legendary Georgetown and Miami teams of my youth. 1. Rise of the Black Style. Intimidation is part of life. The strong get stronger, and the weak get weaker. Patrick Ewing, Georgetown University Center, 1981-85. We were the Muhammad Ali's of that era. Not only were we going to beat you up, we were going to talk to you while we beat you up. Benny Blades, University of Miami defensive back, 1984-87. Columnists called them wilding rogues and thugs. Fans wore t-shirts and held signs aloft at games mocking them as illiterates, convicts, even apes. In tones and language that would be nearly unimaginable today, spectators and even sports writers in the 1980s continued to use thinly veiled racist terms to derogate and demean black college athletes. Legal segregation and overt discrimination against minority student athletes were mostly relics of the recent past, but subtler forms of discrimination persisted. Despite notable progress, black athletes were still not fully assimilated into an intercollegiate sporting experience dominated by white athletes, coaches, administrators, alumni, and fans. It fell to a new generation of black athletes to lead the social and cultural transformation of major college sports. Georgetown University basketball and University of Miami football spearheaded this racial revolution in televised men's team sports during the 1980s. The Georgetown Hoyas and Miami Hurricanes changed the way black athletes competed and performed on the field. The two programs forced universities to reconsider how minority players and coaches were treated, discussed by fans, and covered by the media. By attracting legions of new fans, black and white alike, African-American players transformed sports apparel and marketing and helped turn college basketball and football into multi-billion dollar industries. Specifically, the Hoyas and Hurricanes infused the basketball hardcourts and football gridirons with a new and highly controversial black style of play, a term coined by award-winning New York Times sports columnist William Roden in his 2006 book, $40 Million Slaves. The introduction of African-American athletes to the mainstream marked the beginning of a tremendous influx of black football and basketball players to previously segregated Southern schools, Roden wrote. It also marked the beginning of an intense struggle to control the extent to which African-American style was expressed through sports. The 1980s were the critical transitional decade for college sports. Mostly gone were the patently racist practices common during the post-war period. Those uglier days included threats of violence against black athletes during games, the refusal by many programs and even entire conferences to integrate their teams, or so much as compete against integrated opponents, and the systematic on-campus segregation of minority athletes, even at integrated universities. Black athletes were spat on and verbally harassed by opposing players and coaches. They endured substandard housing accommodations and transportation. Coaches and athletic directors often reprimanded black athletes who protested these abuses. In some cases, black athletes were banned from competition by their own universities. By 1980, Division I team sports were fully integrated, even in the deepest corners of the long-segregated Deep South. Black athletes constituted a growing share of the starting basketball and football lineups at many top-ranked programs. A small, nascent cohort of black head coaches and assistant coaches led college teams. As rosters became more inclusive, so did recruiters. College football and basketball programs attracted new and increasingly diverse audiences that transcended geographic fan bases and racial barriers. Despite these changes, African Americans still represented a tiny share of students and alumni from institutions other than historically black colleges and universities, HBCUs. More than 90% of athletic directors, sports information directors, and other athletic administrators were white. And sports boosters, the alumni who packed football tailgating parking lots and pricey suites at college basketball games, remained overwhelmingly white. Although the National Collegiate Athletic Association, NCAA, and the courts had cleared many of the legal and structural hurdles for black college athletes, in the 1980s they faced enduring obstacles. Born too late for the civil rights movement and anti-Vietnam War protests, this generation of athletes began to challenge persistent on- and off-field sporting norms. How players comported themselves during games. How the media covered the achievements and exploits of black athletes. And how the NCAA and its member conferences treated black student athletes. Racial conflicts in college sports shifted from the court system to the courts of public opinion. The decade was a particularly ripe moment for a racial revolution in televised college sports. At the same time that college football gridirons and basketball hardcourts came to rely on black talent, lucrative broadcast television contracts and sporting apparel endorsements made Division I college basketball and football increasingly profitable industries. The major conferences inked long-term broadcast contracts with the national networks, and the 1979 launch of the innovative all-sports cable channel ESPN promised higher revenues and greater exposure. A pivotal 1984 Supreme Court ruling gave individual universities and conferences the power to negotiate television deals directly with the networks, without approval from the National Collegiate Athletic Association. In early 1980, Sports Illustrated's Curry Kirkpatrick forecast a number of reasons why the 1980s promised change for major college basketball. More black players performing at the big state universities in the South. Additional conferences springing up with accompanying TV exposure, especially in the East. Bigger and better arenas across the land. Players sophisticated enough as freshmen. The NCAA had recently eliminated its ban on freshman participation. To handle conditions on the road, wrote Kirkpatrick. In his 1987 book, Breaking the Ice, about the racial transformation of college football's long-segregated Southwest Conference, SWC, sports historian Richard Pennington reached a similar conclusion about the racial transformation also happening in Division I football. Since blacks are no longer barred from competing, the game is bigger, faster, and far better than before, Pennington wrote. Had blacks been allowed to enroll in SWC institutions and play football in the days of rugby-like balls, leather helmets, and high-top shoes, they would have dominated then, too. Clearly, a revolution has occurred in the SWC football, and if the campus hero no longer has blonde hair and blue eyes, so be it. With a more inclusive appeal, college basketball and football face the prospect of attaining national reach on a scale that athletic directors and media executives long hoped for. The 1980s were also ready-made for racial clashes between good guy white athletes and bombastic bad boy black opponents. In the preceding years, contests suffused with racial subplots drew huge audiences. 4 years after the much-hyped 1975 heavyweight championship bout between Muhammad Ali and Great White Hope Chuck Wepner, the 1979 NCAA men's basketball title game pitting Michigan State's Magic Johnson against Indiana State's Larry Bird became, and to this day remains, the highest-rated televised college basketball game in history. The successes of black players and teams flipped the script on historic imbalances between whites and minorities. Audiences tuned in to watch sporting clashes between the new black Goliaths and white Davids. The rapid racial integration of college sports provided a unique opportunity to university presidents, conference officials, television executives, and corporate sponsors. To capitalize, they needed to expand broadcast college sports following among both black and white spectators. The good news for black athletes was that these developments presented new opportunities and a greater, if still limited, degree of control over their student-athlete experiences. Suddenly, network executives found themselves in expensive bidding wars for the right to broadcast Division I men's college basketball and football games. Sports apparel companies, including Nike and Adidas, likewise competed to ink lucrative sponsorship deals with prominent coaches and notable athletic programs. In theory, a college sports industry increasingly dependent on black and other minority student athletes to deliver their product should have given these athletes greater agency and leverage. The bad news was that new opportunities and greater visibility for black athletes forced university leaders and athletic administrators to respond, and sometimes they responded rashly. To capitalize on the rising value of televised college sports, university and athletic conference leaders asserted greater control over the administration and marketing of their student athletes. Not surprisingly, the growing profitability of major college sports attracted greater scrutiny and even backlash. Alumni, academics, public officials, sports boosters, and the media called for more oversight. Athletic officials found themselves addressing questions that previously went unanswered, if not unasked. What are the appropriate rules for recruiting student athletes? To what academic standards should they be held? What trade-offs should be made between athletes' academic and sporting calendars? What apparel sponsorships and television contracts should universities sign? To claim their share of the sports industrial complex's burgeoning fame and fortune, black athletes and coaches also had to act. Sometimes that meant acting up. The black style refers in part to the heightened competitiveness that black and other minority athletes brought to sports. But as Bill Roden argued, the black style also includes the performative aspects of participation. From sporting apparel to demonstrative victory celebrations to intimidating trash talk. The gestures that make up the black style, the chest bumps, high fives, shakes, and shimmies, are more profound than simple mannerisms, Roden explained. Style is a specialized form of black expression, a consequence of being outside of or other. The black style went beyond mere performance. It was a not-so-subtle reminder to white overseers that the profitability of major college televised sports depended on black participation. Naturally, the black style appealed to newly attentive African-American spectators. But the black style also piqued new interest among white audiences. Many white sports fans tuned in to root against the perfect foils, the black and other minority athletes defeating and sometimes demeaning their opponents. Inevitably, certain players and programs morphed from mere opponents into useful villains. And no two teams in the 1980s welcomed the role of antagonist more than the basketball Hoyas and the football Hurricanes. Georgetown and Miami practiced a proudly racialized style of play. They taunted opponents. They celebrated scores and victories with in-your-face swagger. Intimidation is part of life. The strong get stronger, and the weak get weaker, quipped Georgetown's All-American center Patrick Ewing. We were the Muhammad Ali's of that era, recalled Benny Blades, star defensive back for the 1980s Hurricanes squads. Not only were we going to beat you up, we were going to talk to you while we beat you up. The Hoyas and Hurricanes relished playing the menacing role of Darth Vader in their respective sports. Both programs also left deep imprints on sporting culture beyond the courts and playing fields. Coaches at Georgetown and Miami changed the tenor of post-game media appearances and the language that journalists and broadcasters used to describe athletes. Black and minority athletes at both schools made sports apparel fashionable for younger fans, particularly young, urban African-American males. The two universities' logos and colors quickly spread across urban landscapes as African-Americans who had never set foot on either campus began flashing Miami's orange and green and Georgetown's gray and blue gear. Players consorted with and were glorified by hip-hop artists, including Two Live Crew and NWA. The Hoyas and the Canes were fashionable because they made the bad boy image look good. Popular culture took notice. Perhaps most importantly, Georgetown basketball and Miami football won. The programs may have attracted fans and critics purely by dint of their defiant, chest-thumping style of play. Had they fielded middling teams, however, far fewer spectators and commentators would have paid them any mind. But in fact, the two schools dominated the decade. The Hoyas won 4 of the first 6 Big East Conference tournaments and 6 of the 10 tournaments during the 1980s. In 9 of the decade's years, the Hoyas finished the regular season ranked in the top 20. They played in the NCAA tournament all 10 seasons and reached at least the Elite Eight round in 6 of those 10 years. Georgetown played in the championship game 3 times and won it once during the 4-year span from 1982 to 1985 that coincided with center Patrick Ewing's career. Eric Sleepy Floyd, Reggie Williams, and Charles Smith joined Ewing in earning All-American honors during the decade. After Georgetown's 1984 championship, Sports Illustrated's cover featured Coach John Thompson and Ewing bracketing a grinning President Ronald Reagan. The Hurricanes played in a postseason bowl game in 8 of the decade's 10 seasons, the same number of bowl appearances as in the program's previous 50 years. During a remarkable 7-year run from the 1983 through the 1989 seasons, Miami lost just 11 games, en route to winning 3 national championships. It won a 4th to start the 1990s. During one mid-decade stretch, Miami won 36 consecutive regular season games, a figure equal to more than 3 full seasons of competition. The Hurricanes also held the number one national ranking for more weeks than any other college football program during the 1980s. 14 players received first-team All-American honors from at least one rating organization, including Eddie Brown, Willie Smith, Jerome Brown, Benny Blades, Cleveland Gary, and Vinny Testaverde, who in 1987 became the first Miami player to win the Heisman Trophy, awarded to the sport's top player, cementing the school's reputation as quarterback U. The two programs' most lasting impact was not the titles and trophies they won, but how they infused and eventually normalized the black style in college team sports. In the process, Georgetown and Miami transcended sports to become racial Rorschach tests for the sporting media and for white and black spectators alike. The Hoyas and Canes were as difficult to ignore between games as they were during them. In Georgetown and Miami, many sports fans recognized themselves and their values, or their mirror opposites. The Hoyas and Hurricanes made the rare leap from media and cultural touchstones into true brands because they ratcheted up the stakes of the traditional rivalries that governed collegiate sports fandom. Historically, perennial rivalries pitted the teams, administrators, boosters, and alumni of one university against its in-state, regional, and conference foes. You hated the University of California, Los Angeles, UCLA, because you or your family went to or worked at the University of Southern California, USC, and vice versa. It was as simple as that. Although they were neither the first nor the last programs to do so, Georgetown and Miami helped dissolve these geographic bounds. Wittingly or not, they did so by tapping into reflex so hardwired into the American DNA, it was codified in the original Constitution, the tribalism of race. It's remarkable how unlikely these two universities were to lead a cultural and racial revolution in college sports. Georgetown was a sleepy Jesuit college nestled in a tony corner of northwest Washington, its sports reputation for most of the 20th century, insofar as it had one, was built around sailing, rowing, and track and field. Prior to John Thompson's arrival as the Hoyas coach, the team hadn't made the postseason national basketball tournament since 1943. That year's kiddie court team made it to the title game and lost. The program's most recognizable alums, including future Illinois Congressman Henry Hyde and future National Football League, NFL Commissioner Paul Tagliabue, were known more for their post-Georgetown careers than for what they achieved on the court during their playing days. The university terminated its football program in 1951 and did not revive it again until 1970, and then only at the Division III level. Situated in exclusive Coral Gables, the University of Miami's football program enjoyed a bit more success prior to its 1980s renaissance than Georgetown's long-dormant basketball team. With rosters featuring quarterback George Myra, running back Chuck Foreman, and ferocious defensive lineman Ted Hendricks, the Canes had a brief football heyday during the 1950s and 1960s under coach Andy Gustafson. But the private university's football fortunes plummeted so far that in 1976, the university's board of governors came within one vote of abandoning its football program altogether. Less than 7 years later, the Hurricanes were national champions. Pivotal new coaching hires set the stage for Miami's and Georgetown's revivals. The Hoyas tapped Thompson in 1972 to coach Georgetown basketball. In 1979, the Hurricanes hired Howard Schnellenberger, followed by Jimmy Johnson and Dennis Erickson, as their head football coaches. These four men recruited dozens of superstar black and Latino players during the 1980s, including two of the most prominent figures in their respective programs' sporting renaissances, Hoyas center Patrick Ewing and Hurricanes wide receiver Michael Irvin. Top prep athlete prospects from minority communities across America who might otherwise have never heard of Georgetown or Miami, suddenly pined to play for the Hoyas and Canes. Jimmy Johnson was Miami's path-breaking hire, and he and Georgetown's John Thompson left lasting imprints on their schools and collegiate sports more broadly. One white and the other black, Johnson and Thompson were particularly aware of the degree to which race contributed to their respective teams' national reputations. After leaving Miami in 1989 to coach the NFL's Dallas Cowboys, Johnson talked about the Hurricanes' racialized image during his coaching days in Coral Gables. "We had a lot of black players out front. I think a lot of the resentment came that way. The black players knew that, and the black players knew how I felt. I don't know that there was racism involved in the resentment, but there was some ignorance involved. People who have had few dealings with other ethnic groups. I mean real relationships, not getting somebody to clean your house." Of Thompson, his university president, the Reverend Timothy Healy, said, "This is a man from the Washington area who is taking kids who don't have two coins to rub together and is literally teaching some of them how to use a knife and fork. He knows just what he's doing, and we at Georgetown support him in what he's doing." For his part, Thompson, the 6'10" former center from Providence College and the Boston Celtics, was as central to his team's racial identity as his players. Years later, rapper Chuck D of Public Enemy described the racial potency of those 1980s Hoyas squads this way. "Not only was this a team full of black players who would definitely take it to you, but you had a big-ass black man as a coach who wasn't taking no shit. That was big." The Hoyas and Hurricanes would never have had the temerity to change college athletics without the support and encouragement of their coaches. By defending their players, Thompson and Johnson provided them safe harbor to express themselves. Ever since John Thompson recruited Patrick Ewing 3 years ago, Georgetown has become the team some fans love to hate, New York Times sports writer George Vesey proclaimed in March 1984, a week before the Hoyas won the national championship. "The emotion is not because of Georgetown's considerable ability and discipline, but because of its image of hostility and aggressiveness." As for the loyalty Johnson inspired from his black players, Miami Herald columnist Dan Lebatard said that Randy Shannon, hired by Miami in December 2006, only technically has the technical distinction of being the Hurricanes' first black coach. Jimmy Johnson was the University of Miami's first black coach. In America, sports and race have always been tightly, if sometimes uncomfortably, entwined. From Jack Johnson to Jackie Robinson to Serena Williams, a clear pattern repeats itself. Black athletes who dare to challenge the sporting status quo are vilified initially, but later, if grudgingly, accepted. The 1980s generation of barrier-busting college athletes took this process a step further. Georgetown's and Miami's aggressive style of play angered many fans and commentators, especially at first. Tribal reflexes are difficult to suppress. Yet the black style was not only accepted, but eventually imitated by other athletes, black and white. Opponents wanted to beat them, but also be like them. Love them or hate them, the Hoyas and Hurricanes captivated opponents, fans, and the media. Indeed, these two programs shaped much of what followed in Division I football and basketball. Florida State football's 1988 preseason rap video and the flamboyant antics of cornerback Neon Deion Sanders. The brash, in-your-face 1990 and 1991 University of Nevada, Las Vegas, UNLV, basketball teams, featuring superstar Larry Johnson and the menacing Moses Scurry. And, of course, the baggy shorts and black socks donned by the Fab Five freshmen, who led the University of Michigan's basketball team to back-to-back NCAA championship games in 1992 and 1993. Added to that all-black list are the rebellious on- and off-field stunts of the Oklahoma Sooners' white linebacker Brian Bosworth. Bosworth was an early pioneer in white athletes' appropriation of black effect in collegiate sports. He taunted opponents and flaunted NCAA rules. Bosworth's celebrity made broadcast media and NCAA executives realize that white appropriation of the black style meant bigger radio and TV ratings, which in turn meant more profits. It is impossible to imagine modern sports without the touchdown celebrations and dramatic dunks, the finger-pointing and trash-talking that have become staples of broadcast college basketball and football. Even fans who tended to side with Duke over Michigan in basketball, or rooted for Notre Dame rather than Florida State in football, were drawn to the black style. Fast forward to today, and the lasting impacts of the 1980s transformation on major college sports are clear. The popular and highly profitable NCAA March Madness basketball tournament and the new college football playoff championship would not be the cultural showcases they are today if the seats in the playing arenas and on couches across America were filled almost exclusively by white spectators. Today, African American viewership, 13% for NCAA major bowl games, 14% for the Division I men's March Madness basketball tournament, is comparable to the black shares of the national population and bachelor's degrees earned. African Americans are a very important part of our constituency, ESPN President John Skipper said in February 2016. They watch a lot of sports, and I believe that we have to be their home, and they have to believe that we represent their interests. Simply put, Georgetown basketball and Miami football helped expand and integrate spectatorship in ways that all the visionary college presidents and athletic directors together could not. They broadened the reach of college sports by attracting new white and non-white viewers alike. Some fans tuned in to root for these black athletes, others to root against them. Either way, the Hoyas, Canes, and two subsequent generations of imitators helped make college sports popular and highly lucrative cultural institutions. The NCAA and its allied television and radio networks operate comfortably in the black, thanks in no small measure to the black and other minority athletes who revolutionized college basketball and football. What's perhaps most remarkable about the changes wrought by the two programs is that student athletes, mere amateurs, without salaries or any formalized collective power, were able to exert such a profound impact. It was incredibly difficult in the 1980s for players to feel they had any maneuverability, sports writer Dave Zirin explained. They would look backward and see there was no space to say or do anything. They certainly didn't have a union. They were highly dependent upon word of mouth from coaches, and highly dependent on what then were year-to-year scholarships. The expansion of Division I basketball and football beyond its traditional followership did not occur overnight, nor was it the result of efforts by any single player, coach, team, or university. During the 1980s, however, Georgetown basketball and Miami football led the racial transformation of major college broadcast sports. The Hoyas and Hurricanes shook college sports from its cozy, predominantly white confines and helped broadcast networks and advertisers reach national audiences. They did so, knowingly or not, by capitalizing on the polarizing power of American racial identities. Never far removed from the national discourse, race continues to intersect with politics and NFL players' protests over police brutality. Despite league salary caps that allow professional team owners to pay below market prices for their rosters, critics of the Colin Kaepernick-led protests revived the curious complaint that black athletes, including Kaepernick, are a pack of whiny, overpaid millionaires who should be silently grateful for their success. The legal and structural reforms of the post-war era led to the cultural and social revolutions of the 1980s, which in turn opened the door to the proprietary and political fights still raging in college sports. Although they exercise greater influence today, modern black athletes, coaches, general managers, and owners remain minority stakeholders in both senses of that word. Broadcast college sports today are big business. Sports fandom has broadened with the steady integration of higher education. Millions of spectators tune into the showcase college football playoff and March Madness tournament. Multi-decade broadcast contracts run into the tens of billions of dollars. Every Division I basketball and football conference and their hundreds of member universities depend on the exposure and revenues generated annually by these contracts. The sale of jerseys, hats, sneakers, and countless additional sports-themed paraphernalia embossed with team colors and logos is lucrative for apparel vendors, the memorabilia industry, and, of course, the universities that hold the trademark rights. Georgetown and Miami are not the dominant programs they once were, but they helped forge the corporate and cultural juggernauts of major college men's televised sports. Many notable athletes and coaches from the 1980s heyday of both programs remain prominent in today's national sporting landscape. The Hoyas hired Patrick Ewing in 2017 to be their new head basketball coach. Michael Irvin is a weekly fixture on ESPN's and NFL Network's televised pro football coverage. Former Hurricanes coach Jimmy Johnson is a paid, in-demand television analyst, as was Hoyas coach John Thompson before his death in 2020. Former Hurricanes linebacker Dwayne "The Rock" Johnson is a blockbuster movie star. How did these two formerly unheralded programs lead such a transformation? One answer is that Georgetown and Miami rose to national prominence at the very moment the cultural mainstreaming of African-American life, from the successes of The Cosby Show to the hip-hop innovations of Grandmaster Flash, converged with around-the-clock cable sports programming and big-money collegiate conference competition. A shorter answer is that the Hoyas and Hurricanes infused televised college sports with a new, impossible-to-ignore black style of play, and won. One style, two variants. No other men's college teams dominated the 1980s like Georgetown and Miami. Both teams were proud purveyors of the black style, yet each program practiced its own variant of that style. Georgetown held no monopoly on rough play, but the Hoya signature was a brusque, physical form of basketball, rarely witnessed in the college game in previous eras. With towering centers Ewing and later Alonzo Mourning, the Hoyas sought to project their physical dominance. Formed in 1979, the Big East Conference, in which Georgetown, Syracuse, and St. John's were charter members, quickly developed a reputation for physicality that perfectly suited Thompson's Hoyas. In the early 1980s, tensions between Big East teams often boiled over. A few player skirmishes led to fisticuffs, and relationships among the conference's coaching staffs frequently soured. Thompson coaches aggressively, and his team is an extension of him on the court, New York Times sports writer Peter Alfano observed. The Hoyas play an almost bullying style that can intimidate opponents and challenge the spirit of the rules which pertain to contact. Rough play was a signature of Georgetown games. Opponents routinely pushed and fouled Ewing hard in an effort to rattle the All-American. The quick-tempered Ewing answered these aggressions with glowering facial expressions, verbal retorts, and occasionally his fists. After losing to the Hoyas three times by an average of more than 20 points during Ewing's 1981-82 freshman season, conference rival St. John's was determined not to be pushed around the following year. In a 76-67 victory over the Hoyas in early January 1983, Redmond forward Kevin Williams lured Ewing into two altercations that whipped both teams and the Madison Square Garden crowd into a frenzy. Williams suffered a swollen lip courtesy of a Ewing punch, but Williams's needling tactics during the game achieved their intended effect. Ewing missed 10 of 14 shots from the field, and the Hoyas lost a winnable game. During his post-game comments, Thompson warned Big East referees that if they permitted smaller players to harass Ewing with impunity, he would advise his superstar sophomore to turn professional at season's end. Critics chirped that a skinny Ewing would suffer worse beatings from centers in the pro game, something the National Basketball Association, NBA, veteran Thompson surely knew to be true. But Thompson also knew he got the attention of league officials and profit-minded network executives, who didn't want to risk two seasons' worth of lower ratings and ad revenues if Ewing turned pro early. Before the rise of one-year-and-done superstars, Ewing was a media meal ticket. Had Ewing chosen to play for Jim Calhoun, Tom Davis, or Rick Pitino at Northeastern, Boston College, and Boston University, respectively, it takes no stretch of the imagination to state that those fans and media members would have been more accepting of his posture and style of play, the bullseye on his back much less visible and savored, argued sports historian Alejandro Danwa. Ewing was frequently targeted for verbal and even racial abuse by opposing spectators, especially white fans. Responding to reports that Ewing had struggled to meet the academic standards required for admission to Georgetown, opposing fans routinely held up signs at games with phrases like, "the missing link," to taunt and demean the 7-foot center. In a 1983 game against the Villanova Wildcats at Philadelphia's Palestra Arena, Wildcats supporters threw a banana on the court during the pregame introduction of Georgetown's starting lineup. One Villanova fan hoisted a bedsheet proclaiming, "Ewing is an ape," and others donned t-shirts declaring, "Ewing can't read this," with a backwards E in front of Ewing, and "can't" and "dis" misspelled. Infuriated, Hoyas coach John Thompson pulled his players from the court in protest until the signs were removed. "It is cheap, racist stuff," bemoaned Georgetown's president, the Reverend Timothy Healy. "No one on the face of the earth can tell me if Patrick were a 7-foot-high white man, that people would still carry these signs around. I'm a white man, and I know it." Thompson occasionally complained to Big East conference officials, but decided to handle matters mostly on his own. "Coach Thompson tried to shield myself and the rest of the team from some of the negative things that were being said," recalls Ewing. Thompson cut an imposing figure. The former Providence College and Boston Celtics center stood literally head and shoulders above his fellow Big East coaches, Lou Carnesecca of St. John's and Villanova's Rolly Massimino. Having coached at a Washington prep school before taking the Georgetown job, Thompson knew how to recruit players from tough urban neighborhoods. He drew heavily from the talented stocks of nearby Washington and Baltimore public schools that served economically disadvantaged, overwhelmingly African-American communities. The Jamaica-born Ewing was an exception. He attended a Boston private school on scholarship. Aside from a white reserve or two, Thompson's Hoyas teams were entirely composed of black players. Thompson's growing reputation as the nation's most successful Division I black coach surely advantaged him in the recruiting wars. Thompson was extremely protective of his team's racial identity. He knew opponents and critics hated his Hoyas precisely because of their image, and he welcomed their enmity. In 1981-82, only the Big East's third season, Thompson became the first black coach to reach the Division I men's championship game. 2 years later, he was the first black coach to win a major championship in any college team sport. Thompson and his players instantly became role models for black America. African-American adults pulled for the Hoyas because Thompson played out the black man of power role, the way many of them wish they had the authority and courage to do in the workplace, argued Curtis Bunn of the Atlanta Black Star on the occasion of the 30-year anniversary of Ewing's 4-year reign at Georgetown. Thompson orchestrated and executed things his way, without the consideration, and often to the intentional ire, of white people, but always with sound reasoning. Although he and his players kept their chins up, racial abuse took its inevitable toll. "Ignorance has no color," Thompson said in March 1983, almost exactly a year after the heartbreaking championship game loss to the University of North Carolina, UNC, and a year prior to the Hoyas' redemptive 1984 title win over Houston. "The point isn't that this season has been degrading to a black man. It has been degrading to any man. On the airplane last week, I asked Patrick Ewing again how he was holding up. He told me, 'I've grown accustomed to it. I got so much of it in high school.' That made me saddest of all." Not every attack against Thompson's Hoyas was racially motivated, of course. The team's on-court successes made Georgetown a target for conference opponents and other national contenders, most of which also featured lineups chock full of black players. But overlaying the normal tensions of competitive athletics was a unique racial antipathy directed at Georgetown. Because his team and players were depicted as antagonists, Thompson could, to some degree, be forgiven his frequent refusal to make his players available to reporters. His reflexive defensiveness, Hoya paranoia, as the media called it, was often justified. Nothing is simple about John Thompson, a smart and sensitive and very large man, who, besides knowing how to recruit and coach, has an outsider's sense of self-protective paranoia. New York Times columnist George Vesey wrote a few days after the ugly fracas between Kevin Williams and Patrick Ewing in the 1983 St. John's Georgetown game. Nor would Georgetown be bullied by conference officials or media executives. Then Washington Post sports writer John Feinstein saw firsthand how Thompson-helmed Georgetown blossomed from an unknown program into a national powerhouse, and the added scrutiny the Hoyas attracted. As early as 1984, Feinstein reported that Thompson and athletic director Frank Rienzo took flack because they ran their program differently. These differences include often hardline negotiations for game contracts with other schools that, among other things, virtually wipe out local rivalries. The differences extend to relationships with television networks, radio stations, magazine, and newspaper reporters, Feinstein observed. Some players and coaches complain that the Hoyas are too aggressive on the court, all of which leads in general to an image of being difficult to deal with, and resulting in the phrase, Hoya paranoia. Georgetown's aggressive posture was a direct extension of Thompson's pugilistic personality. Thompson sought to dismantle pervasive negative stereotypes about black athletes. He insisted they be students, not merely athletes, and role models to their campus peers and the broader community. Instead of scrimmaging, reviewing game film, or doing wind sprints, Thompson held impromptu mental practices a few times each season, during which players sat in the bleachers for as long as 2 hours, discussing current events. He hired an academic advisor, Mary Fenlon, solely dedicated to the players' scholastic performance. Fenlon traveled with the team and even sat on the bench alongside the players during games. As star center Dikembe Mutombo learned the hard way, Thompson's no-excuses militarism also applied to his players in the classroom. Mutombo once skipped class for a dental emergency, but failed to alert Thompson or anyone in the program about his toothache. When Mutombo showed up for practice that afternoon, he found a one-way ticket to Kinshasa, his hometown in the Republic of the Congo, now the Democratic Republic of the Congo, waiting for him inside his locker. Mutombo approached Thompson in a panic. Thompson said he was sending Mutombo home to his father and possible service in dictator Mobutu Sese Seko's army. "I could not believe it," Mutombo later recalled. "I thought it was the end of my education." Thompson chided his player for not scheduling the appointment around his classwork, but forgave him. Thompson silenced some of his detractors and critics of how he presented himself as a black man by adopting and even exaggerating traditionally white norms. What appeared as stridency was, in fact, Thompson practicing his own militarized version of the black style. Jeff Bullis, a star white forward for the Hoyas in the late 1970s, described the racial dynamics of Thompson's military-inspired coaching philosophy. "On this team, the black-white thing just doesn't come up until some reporter starts asking questions. It's hard to explain how close we are, but we're closer, I think, than any of the teams we've played," explained Bullis. "That's how Mr. Thompson wants it, and that's the kind of people Mr. Thompson recruits. We're like a military unit that has gone through a lot of fire together. Mr. Thompson is the fire. He's very tough, but if you can take it, he'll make a man out of you." Bullis's references to Thompson as Mr. rather than coach are telling. Thompson wanted sports writers and other coaches to associate him and his teams with military-style discipline because he understood what critics meant when they described players as undisciplined. Said Thompson, undisciplined. That means the N-word. They're all big and fast and can leap like kangaroos and eat watermelon in the locker room. But they can't play as a team, and they choke under pressure. It's the idea that a black man doesn't have the intelligence or the character to practice self-control. In basketball, it's been a self-fulfilling prophecy. White men run the game. A white coach recruits a good black player. He knows the kid's got talent, but he also knows, or thinks he knows, that because he's black, he's undisciplined. So he doesn't try to give the player any discipline. He puts him in the freelance one-on-one hot dog role and turns to the little white guard for discipline. Other black kids see this and they think this is how they are expected to play, and so the image is perpetuated. At a press conference the day before his Hoyas won the 1984 national championship, a reporter asked Thompson how he felt about his team being described in militaristic terms. Thompson said he loved it. "You'll never hear one of our players criticize a player on another team," he explained. "If you do, you come to me, and then I'll really become militaristic." 5 days later, when President Ronald Reagan hosted the champion Hoyas at a celebratory event on the White House lawn, the president's staff had clearly prepped Reagan well. "I understand there's been some criticism, Coach Thompson, that maybe your coaching was a little too stringent, or almost military," Reagan remarked. "I wouldn't let that bother me at all. It's results that pay off." Thompson took the remark as a compliment. "If the worst thing that could ever be said about us is that we're military, I feel very honored." Thompson's black style served twin purposes: to build cohesive and disciplined players on his mostly black teams, and to shatter the racist tropes so often applied to black athletes. If that meant imposing a harsh discipline on his players, so be it. In the 1984 Big East Conference Final against rival Syracuse, Georgetown won the title in an overtime classic. The very physical game is remembered for, and some say marred by, a fight between Hoyas forward Michael Graham and Orangemen forward Andre Hawkins. After the game, the media questioned Thompson about his team's intimidating posture and rough play. Thompson gave it right back to the media, saying there were times during the season when he brought Ewing to post-game press conferences, but certain reporters seemed too scared to pose questions to his towering center. Sports Illustrated's Curry Kirkpatrick described Thompson's remarks this way: "That happened to be Thompson at his gruff, mean-spirited, iconoclastic, and odd-humored best. And though his methods may be questionable, his intentions seem laudable. He's a surpassingly bright, deep, discerning, and articulate fellow who genuinely cares about his players' academic attainments. Their graduation rate is very high." Nonetheless, on occasion, Thompson plays the tough guy role to the hilt, complete with such witty repartee as "get out of my face." More often than not, his team, along with its leather jackets and chains image, appears to slip into precisely the same character. But of course, that's the point. Indeed, that was exactly the point. Thompson projected strength and even mean-spiritedness as part of his defiant, militant application of the black style. He was more than happy to absorb criticism if it meant deflecting attention away from his players. Colonels, not corporals, shoulder the burdens of responsibility. In the 1980s, Georgetown was a national power and natural antagonist. Hoyas games were must-see television for sports fans and a hot topic for discussion in the sports media. With their blue and gray uniforms, a color scheme the university had adopted to recognize both sides of the Civil War, and nearly all-black roster of superstar players, the Hoyas' evil empire image agitated many white fans and delighted their black supporters. Georgetown was a basketball juggernaut and a potent racial icon. Like Georgetown, the Miami Hurricanes were collegiate bad boys who stood defiantly on the black side of the racial color line. Miami used physical and psychological taunts and a variety of pregame and in-game tactics designed to intimidate and even embarrass opponents. The Hurricanes celebrated touchdowns and turnovers in inventive, often excessive ways. Referees penalized the Hurricanes for their showmanship on the field. Sports writers criticized Miami for breaking historical norms of sportsmanship. But lost yardage on the field and media criticisms off the field were offset by gains where they mattered most, on the scoreboard. The most amazing part of the Hurricane story is that Miami almost dropped football in 1976, 7 years before it won its first national championship. 5 years after Miami's fateful hiring of Howard Schnellenberger, Miami beat the vaunted Nebraska Cornhuskers, one of the most dominant teams in the history of college football, to win the school's first national title. The Hurricanes were already being shoehorned into the role of bad boys. The media could have jumped on the bandwagon and hyped up the Cinderella story of a team almost losing its program to national championship. It could have looked at all the kids from an area torn apart by racial tensions and how the school was able to unite the people of all races, white, black, Hispanic, lamented Bleacher Report correspondent Anakin Kane. The media could have jumped at an opportunity to promote these kids coming from drug-infested communities, one-parent families, welfare culture, and the projects. Instead, the media fed the hatred for years to come. Terms such as thug you and convict you came into college football's lexicon. That critique is accurate, if a bit premature. Miami's bad boy image actually blossomed under the stewardship of Coach Jimmy Johnson, the man hired to replace Schnellenberger after the latter quit to take what turned out to be a failed deal with the United States Football League's expansion into Miami. Johnson was more bombastic and expressive than the buttoned-down Schnellenberger. The black style that Johnson embraced, however, differed from Thompson's militaristic mien. Johnson believed in a player-centric, permissive, and flamboyant style. In his autobiography, Johnson, a psychology major in college, offered his socio-psychological explanation for why many of his urban black athletes acted the way they did. We had some players who came from very deprived backgrounds. That in no way hindered their quality as men and as citizens. It did in some cases leave them with insecurities they had to work out and overcome. If you've grown up in the hard environments of Pahokee or Homestead, and suddenly find yourself walking the well-to-do environs of the University of Miami campus in Coral Gables, there is some adjustment to be made. And so, to mask nervousness, anxiety, and insecurity, some of our players behaved quite the opposite way on the football field. Cool, supremely confident, joyful. They exulted in their success, and they were demonstrative about it. Confidence is necessary to play football. Different players have different ways of building confidence. If I stymied and handcuffed the players who needed to be demonstrative, I would stymie and handcuff their confidence. Because of a lot of our players' backgrounds, we had to be somewhat flamboyant. Johnson told his players not to repress their personalities. He never put any bars on us, running back Cleveland Gary said. He never told us how to act, how to behave. Johnson coached and mentored black athletes from economically disadvantaged environments in South Florida, similar to the Baltimore and Washington neighborhoods where Thompson recruited many of his players. But Johnson's confidence-based theory of the black style contrasted sharply with Thompson's disciplinarian approach. Johnson's approach often backfired. Under Johnson's, and later Dennis Erickson's, stewardships, Miami racked up repeated sanctions for its on- and off-field discipline. In addition to the NCAA's adoption of the so-called Miami Rule regarding celebratory on-field antics, from the mid-1980s into the 1990s, a veritable parade of Hurricanes players were penalized for scholastic or legal problems. Of course, as white coaches, Johnson and Dennis Erickson enjoyed greater lateral to be rogue stewards of their program than Thompson did at Georgetown. Miami's behavior, like Georgetown's, drew the ire of opposing players, coaches, and the media. White fans and critics in particular scorned the Hurricanes for their style of play. These criticisms only bonded the players, coaches, and university with their fans and the city of Miami. Sports writer Dan Lebatard attended Miami as an undergraduate, and upon graduation became the Miami Herald's young beat writer covering Hurricanes football. The 80s and early 90s were renegade rebellion. Notre Dame star Tim Brown said he had genuine fear that those teams would beat him up in the parking lot after games. They were scary good and scary, Lebatard recalled of those formative-era Miami teams. The early years were so us against the world in ways that transcended the athletic cliché of invented doubters and critics. Those teams were so crazy that it made the bond stronger with the city. Hurricanes players and coaches were keenly aware of how integral the black style was for the reputation of the U, the shorthand players began to use for their football program. They also recognized that they were practicing a form of sports psychological warfare others had invented. Long before the collegians of the 1980s were born, pioneering African-American athletes from Satchel Paige to Jack Tatum to Muhammad Ali mastered the same psychological tactics. The athletic struggle between white protagonists and black antagonists did not begin with University of Miami football in the 1980s. The 1987 Fiesta Bowl between No. 2 Penn State and No. 1 Miami to determine the national champion is remembered as a notably racialized contest. Billed as the game of the century, the matchup pitted two undefeated teams in the first true national title game under the NCAA's new bowl matchup format. As if that were insufficient hype for the game, the media portrayed the contest as nothing less than an existential battle of light versus dark. On one side stood the understated Penn State student-athletes, with no last names on their jerseys. On the other stood the finger-pointing Miami show-offs, who supposedly never cracked a book. The general feeling was that Miami was just a bunch of rogues, recalled television analyst Beano Cook. They made Penn State good because everyone wanted to say Miami is evil, and so it became good versus evil. The polarized depictions of the two teams were exaggerations. Even many Penn State players, who had heard all year about the Hurricanes' reputation for swagger, knew the truth was more complicated. If you're told a lie for long enough, you start to believe it. Nittany Lions defensive tackle.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.